imagine it's been another very full week for us, with Michelle being in the hospital all week and working in the days and trying to stay at the hospital, give Deb a little break in the evenings. And I think that's probably going to be a reflection of my whole sermon today. So I kind of wanted to set the stage with that to give you an idea. Sometimes when you're sitting with someone, and I, we sat with her. There was a couple of really bad days there. You got me, Bill? Okay. So, and so we were sitting with her, and as I sat there one evening, I couldn't help but just start thinking about our great God. You know, God is always with us. And as I'm sitting there thinking, I thought, how terrible it is what we have done in this world. From this standpoint, God, sometimes simple says it all. And our God has just given us such a simple approach to understanding Him. And we have made Christianity so complicated that people get all confused with it. And we start looking at all the different avenues. So today, I want to talk about just something that's so simple. Whenever I'm done, some of you are going to say, well, that didn't take much time. And others are going to say, yeah, I get it. Because it's just so simple. Let's talk about being secure. Everyone wants to be secure in something. We all want to be secure in this journey through life that we're taking. We want to be secure in our family. We want to know that all is well with our family and that everything under our roof that we call family, that everything's solid, secure. I don't want to have to worry about my kids being in trouble. I don't want to have to worry about them being mean to me. I just want it secure. You kind of get the idea. We all want that. All of us guys want that, you know. So we get this idea. We want it secure. I don't want to feel insecure either about my friends, family and friends. I believe in friendship. And if I'm your friend, you can count on that. And that's what I want from friends. You know, I don't want this fickle stuff. This, you never know where they're at. I want to be secure in my finances. I want to be able to know that whenever we send that check out tomorrow, it's probably not going to bounce. Yeah, I'd like to be more secure than that. We want to be secure in those things. I want to be secure in enjoyment. The things that I enjoy in life. I love my car. You all know that. I kind of feel secure with that. I want to be secure in my employment. I don't want to come in some Sunday and see a help wanted sign hanging up sign by me. I wouldn't feel very good about that. I want to be secure in life in general. But we soon learn there are not a lot of guarantees in our life, are there? And all these securities that I've just talked about, let's think about them again. Family. I think the family is in more trouble than I can remember in my lifetime. Most of you probably agree with that. We see things that are transpiring, taking place, and we think, what happened to the good old days? Does anyone else ever feel that way? Of course you do. I want to be that thing of friendship. You ever hear the expression fair weather friends? Yeah. Sometimes we find that there's a lot of fair weather friends out there and they're not real secure. I've been very blessed. So many of you who are my friends have checked on me every day or just said a prayer for me. We'd like to be secure in our finances, but we find out that we're living in a world where there are no securities in finances. Everything changes every day. We want to be secure in our enjoyment, but enjoyment today, sometimes that's hard to find. Something that we are just really enjoying about life. In our employment, well, I just saw where some company was laying off 500 people, and I thought, wow, how terrible. How terrible. Companies that used to hold families for their entire career, now it's kind of hitting this. That's scary, folks. So what's secure in our world? Well, Christianity is so simple. There's one security that we have, and I'm going to give you three aspects of it. Number one, God can't change. That's a great security for me. God cannot change. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, the most logical verse, it says, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Life sure does change, doesn't it? Everyone else knows how much your life is changing? It just changes every day. I found out that every day when I get up, there's a new ache somewhere. My life changes every day in some way or another. So that life is changing. My needs have changed throughout the years. The needs that I've had have just gone from one extreme to the other, it seems like. Those needs are always changing. Sometimes we have those needs to have a little security nest. Other times we have those needs to know that everything's all right. Needs change every day as well. My wants change. I used to always want an old car, you know that. I used to have all types of old cars, old Camaros, old coupes, old Mustangs. Well, a couple years ago, my need changes and I got a new Mustang. It just helped, you know, I didn't have to worry about it. Those wants change. We all know that those wants change. Our financial security changes, but God never changes. Ain't that a pretty simple fact? Whenever we really start thinking about it, our God is going to be the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, I'm a person who doesn't really like change. I don't deal well with it. I just don't like change at all. I'm pretty sure that the Beach Boys should be the main music out there today. Buddy Holly, the Beach Boys, the Monkees, I was good with all of that. I was watching something the other night, and they said, this is the newest artist out. I thought, I didn't even know it changed, because I'd never heard the name before. Somebody said Prince had been a singer. I had no idea. Now, does that mean me? I didn't know about all that stuff. I thought Purple Rain was some kind of acid falling out of the sky. I really didn't know that it was a song. Really didn't care, by the way. I guess you know I didn't want to leave my car out either, okay? So you get the idea. I really don't like change. I tolerate it. I tolerate it. Now, I want you to know that's good for all of you, because for all of you who have been here the 40 years that I have, I look out and I see you like you looked 40 years ago. Now, that makes you feel better. Some of you weren't even here 40 years ago. Yeah, I just really am not very partial to change. I not only don't like change, I don't even really want to tolerate it, so I'm really thankful. As I said the other night, I'm so thankful that my God never changes. That He's just like He was whenever I first met Him in 1970. That He's a God that I was introduced to and someone said, He loves you. And I know He still loves me today. James chapter 1 verses 17 and 18. I'm going to say this. Chapter 1, verses 17 and 18. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chooses to give us birth through the Word. He has helped me to be reborn through His Word, that we might be a kind of first fruit of all He created. He's helped me to change. Our God has provided gifts for this change that is going to transpire. Now, used to our securities, every one of us, we have based our securities in finances, in houses, in automobiles, in feeling those secure things of life. But our God has given us a new means of basing our security, and it's not on things, it's on Him and our relationship with Him. He provides all of our priorities to change if we are looking for total security in God. If you're wanting God to help secure your life, what are we going to look at? Well, in Galatians, He's going to say, look at love. What about your circle of love since you've become a Christian? Has it become more dependent on, more meaningful? I hope that it has. Because that's what Christianity is going to provide for you. What about the joy, the peace, the patience, the kindness, the goodness, the faithfulness, the gentleness, and the self-control? All of these are gifts of God to show us that He hasn't changed and to provide for a new security for you. Whenever you are of the world, your security is of the world. You can't get enough security. You can't get enough dollars in the bank. You can't get enough toys. You can't get a big enough house. Because our security becomes wrapped up in those things. But whenever we found this whole new life in Jesus, whenever we realize that we have an unchanging God, now let's think about the things that have changed. We'll just make it simple. Let's stick with my favorite topic, cars. Did anyone drive a Model T here today? Did anyone drive a Model A? Anyone drive anything earlier than a 50? 1950? Well, you have, but you're not now. Anyone drive one? I checked the parking lot. There's none out there. So all of these changes have transpired. And remember that first new car you bought? You thought, man, this is great. I love this thing. And what happened? About the second year of the payment, you're thinking, can I get rid of this? Yeah. Everything changes. Now I want you to think about your relationship with God. I want all of you to kind of refocus on, I'd like to take you back. I want you to go back to the day that you come down the aisle and you made that decision and you said, I love you, God. I want you to go back to that day that you first felt God put his arms around you. I want you to go back to that day when you realized, you know, I feel pretty good about life. There's some joy in my heart that I didn't have before. I want you to go back to that day. Now, if you have struggled to walk the walk, that's still there. Now, if you didn't walk the walk, it's still there. Or if you walked the walk and even grown in it, it has grown! And it's fantastic that all of a sudden I'm living life with a peace that I've never had before. That is the security of an unchanging God. Because God never changes. He loves you as much the first day as he does now. And he's right there to help us each step of the way. And he's trying to help us redirect those priorities in our life. So that whenever we're looking at those priorities, whenever we're sitting back and saying, you know, I think I need, then we start looking at his goodness, faithfulness, and, oh God, you've been so gentle with me. I like the gentleness. God's helped me become more of a gentle person. I've had my day when I wasn't too gentle. And he's helped me become more of a gentle person. But I think about the gentleness that God has handled me with. Folks, I wasn't a work in progress. I am still a work in progress. Every day God is gently redirecting me to a new place and new thoughts. So our God, he never changes on us. Our God is not movable. I thought that was another fantastic, simple thing about God. Isaiah 26, verse 4, will say this. Trust in the Lord forever. For the Lord, is the rock eternal. Now I enjoy the mountains. And I enjoy the big boulders that sit out there on the side of the mountain. And you can go out and you can crawl up on it if you're good enough. You can get up on that and you can sit there and it's not going to roll down the hill, even with your measly little weight on it. You can put your feet up against it. You can't push it off that hill. I enjoy the mountains. Those big, massive rocks. They're solid and stable and unmovable. Isaiah uses that visual that we all have. He uses a visual that we can all understand that describes God to us. He said, our God is like one of those huge rocks. He's not movable. He's not going to move on you. He's not sitting here today and over here next week. He's not going to move around us. He's a rock eternal. He's a foundation. That rock that we're talking about is a foundation that we can build our lives and our family on. A foundation, a solid rock that we can build upon. One that we can build our lives on. Let's go with lives first and then the family. We have to build an individual life. Now you have a family. We'll get to that in a minute. Now, if you're just building your family on that rock, you're suffering. And often I believe families suffer because they're not doing anything individual building. You need to individually build on that foundation as well. I've told you 100 times, and I'll tell you one more. If you don't have a good devotional, get one. You need to be building individually on this solid rock foundation that God has given you. That you have your personal relationship, not your family devotion, not your family time, your time. As you are on this rock, And I want you to visualize sitting there on that big boulder, and you're all by yourself. It's just you and the rock. And you're right there. Because if you are not building individually, folks, you're suffering. Your family can't carry all of it as a unit. You have to do this individually first. Now, if you want your family unit to be really strong, work on your individual growth. If you want your family devotion, your family love of God to be really strong, it starts with you as an individual. So here it is, you and the Lord, this solid rock, this eternal rock that is always there, never changing. Now let's establish our family upon that. So I've started building my own strength through this rock. And now Deb and the kids come in to this circle. Now, how good is that circle going to be? It's only going to be as good as the individuals in that circle. So now you're wanting each member of the family to build. You're wanting each member of the family to be working on their personal relationship with God. Because then as a unit, wow, the wind and the waves can come, but nothing will rock the house. Psalms 102 verse 27 will say this. But you remain the same, speaking of God, but you remain the same, and your years will never end. He's the same. Never ending. He's forever and ever and ever. Never ending. Now, he's the same in my household as he was in Noah's. The same. That's a long distance. And he's the same in each of those households. He's the same in my household as he was in King David's. And the King David was the greatest of all kings. And he's the same in my humble home as he was in the home of the king. He's the same as he was in Solomon, who possessed the world's wealth. Now let's take King David and King Solomon. King David was the greatest of all kings, and why? Did he stumble? Well, he did stumble a few times, didn't he? He stumbled more than a few times. I really like David. I can associate with him. I've stumbled once or twice. Three or four. Five or six. Okay. I've stumbled a few times. What about King David? He stayed focused, though, on God. Even though he stumbled, what did he do? He'd get up and brush himself off. Continue trying to do his best for the kingdom that God had given him. What about Solomon? Solomon was so focused on Solomon that he went from a great start where he said, God, bless me in wisdom, till he closes out by saying, God, haven't I guessed what he wants? Well, maybe he didn't say that. He's thinking it. And each wife, each foreign wife that he married, what did he do? He brought their false god in for them. And what happened to his home? It crumbled. And what happened to the kingdom? It divided. See, it starts individually. It starts with right there, right now, with you. Because this great God of ours, he never moves. He's a solid rock. So he said, build upon build your house upon me. He's always firm. He's always solid. He's always immovable. You always know where to find him. He's not far from any of us, the scripture says. You always know where to find him. So we go looking for him, and where's he at? Well, he's right where you left him. He didn't move. He's right there, solid, unchanging, unmovable. Pretty simple gospel, folks. That's pretty simple. You don't have to be a great psychologist or brain surgeon to figure it out. It's pretty simple. What a great God we have. He made it good for me, and if I can understand it, anyone can understand it. Here's the last one. This great unchanging God of ours, he can't stop being God. He can't stop being God. Psalms 90 and verse 2. Before the mountains were born, before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You ever know anyone who decided to drop out of life? Just quit. I've known a couple of people who just, I had a high school buddy who just decided he's going to drop out. And he just finally dropped out. He dropped out of school, he dropped out of life, he just dropped out. And a few years later, he woke up. Well, I think most of us have known someone who just decided to drop out of life. That'd be like me saying, now folks, I'm still going to be a minister, but don't call me because I'm not going to, I'm dropping out for the next 2 months. Wouldn't that really work? Might work for you, but it wouldn't work for me. Sometimes we just know people that drop out. God takes no vacations. He's not going to drop out. He's not going to stop being God. He's not going to stop covering all the bases. He's not going to stop being that solid rock. He's not going to stop being unchangeable. He's always going to be there. God can and won't do that to you because he's going to be your God. And as your God and you're that individual building upon that rock foundation, as your God and you're on that rock and you're trying to make your life better, what's going to take place? There's going to be time when you've got to talk to the rock. And as you're talking to the rock, here's the greatest thing about talking to our rock, he'll talk back. He's going to speak back to you. It may be through your heart, it may be through your mind, it may be through someone else. But our God is going to give a message to you. Because he's God. He's the great God of heaven. The great God of the universe. He's the creator of all things. And he's not going to quit. So when you get up in the morning, he's still your God. And you may say, I don't want a God. That's on you. But our God will be the same as he was yesterday when you wanted him. He'll be the same God whenever you're in grief as you are when you're in joy. He'll be a God that's going to walk with you. He's going to be a God, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28 says he's the creator. Do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator. Get that, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary in his understanding. No one can fathom. I don't understand him. I just know that he's there. That's where I want you to be. I want you to know that our gospel is so simple. That our God knows every aspect of you. And he's not going to stop being your God. Just because you stumble, just because you fall, just because you stub your toe, he's not going to stop. Just because you get up and you're singing hallelujah tonight, you're singing something else. He's not going to stop being your God. He's going to be a God who is finding a way to reach deep within your soul. He's going to be looking for a way to minister to those deep, dark pains. He's going to be looking for a way to minister to that newfound joy that you have. That's where God is. He's going to be a God who's looking to say, I need to walk with you for a little while. And then maybe like footprints in the sand, he's going to be a God who says, I need to pick you up and carry you for a little while. That's who our God is. He's not going to quit being God. He's going to be a God that whenever you're having the greatest of all days, he's going to smile with you. He's going to be a God that whenever you're having a miserable day, he's going to hurt with you. And he's going to try to get you by the hand, or he's going to try to put his arms around you and help you through. That's who our God is. He's unchangeable. He's unmovable. He never stops being God. He's a God who's going to love you whenever it's a good day. He's going to love you when you're having a bad day. He's a God who's never going to give up on you. You ever have anyone give up on you? I've had people give up on me all my whole life. It dates way back. God never did. Whenever it looked like I wouldn't make it, God was there pulling me along. When it looked like I was going too far, too fast, he'd get in front of you and slow me down. That's who our God is. He never quits being your God. He loves you, folks. He wants you to know it. He wants each of you to know I'm not going to change. I'm not going to be moved. And I'm not going to quit. He's sending you a message. Get used to me. I'm here to stay. Get used to me. I'm here to stay. You may not invite him in, but remember the guy standing at the door and knocking? He's right there. He's knocking today. We all please stand wherever he is.